in our unsaved state, but through the mercies and the power of thy gracious Holy Spirit, O Lord, convert souls, bring us to come to an end to our sins, and to look unto Christ, the author and the finisher of our faith. We ask these blessings in his name and for his sake. Amen.
Amen.
Great Redeemer's praise. Psalm 38 and Psalm 38. O Lord, rebuke me not in thy wrath, neither chasten me in thy own displeasure. For thine arrows stick fast in me, and thy hand presseth me sore. There is no soundness in my flesh because of thine anger, neither is there any rest in my bones because of my sin. For my iniquity are gone over my head, and as an heavy burden they are too heavy for me. My wounds stink and are corrupt because of my foolishness. I'm troubled, I'm bowed down greatly. I go mourning all the day long, for my loins are filled with a loathsome disease, and there is no soundness in my flesh. I'm feeble and sore broken. I have wrought by reason of the disquietness of my heart. Lo, all my desire is before thee, and my groaning is not hid from thee. My heart panted, my strength failed me. As for the light of mine eyes, it also is gone from me. My lovers and my friends stand aloof from my soul, and my kinsmen stand afar. They also that seek after my life lay snares for me, and they that seek my heart speak mischievous things, and imagine deceits all the day long. But I, as a deaf man, heard not, and I was as a dumb man that opened not his mouth. Thus I was as a man that hears not, and in whose mouth I have no reproofs. For indeed, O Lord, do I hope, thou wilt hear, O Lord my God. For I said, hear me, lest otherwise they should rejoice over me. When my foot slipped, they magnify themselves against me. For I am ready to halt, and my soul is continually before me. For I will declare my iniquity. I will be sorry for my sin. But mine enemies are lively, and they are strong, and they that hate me wrongfully are multiplied. They also that render evil for good are my adversaries, because I follow the thing that good is. Forsake me not, O Lord, O my God, be not far from me. Make haste to help me, O Lord, my salvation. Bless the reading and the hearing of his word. Let's sing together our second hymn. Hymn number 23, verse 5. Hymn number 23, verse 5. The Lord, my shepherd is, I shall be well supplied.
Thank you.
said unto Assos, that intending to take him home, for so had he appointed, minding himself to go of him. And when he met with us at Assos, we took him in and came to Italy. And we sailed thence and came to the next day over against Chios. And the next day we arrived at Samos, and tarried at Trogyllium, and the next day we came to Miletus. For Paul had determined to sail by Ephesus, because he would not spend the time in Asia, for he hastened, if it were possible for him, to be at Jerusalem the day of Pentecost. And from Miletus he sent to Ephesus, and called the elders of the church. And when they were come to him, he said unto them, ye know from the first day that I came into Asia, after what manner I have been with you at all seasons, serving the Lord with all humility of mind, and with many tears and temptations, which befell me by the body in weight of the Jews, and how I kept back nothing that was profitable unto you, but have showed you and have taught you publicly and from house to house, testifying both to the Jews and also to the Greeks, repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. And now, behold, I go bound in the Spirit unto Jerusalem, not knowing the things that shall befall me there, save that the Holy Ghost witnesses in every city, saying that bonds of afflictions abide me. But none of these things move me, neither count I my life dear unto myself, so that I might finish my course with joy, and the ministry which I have received of the Lord Jesus, to testify the gospel of the grace of God. And now, behold, I know that ye all among whom I have gone preaching the kingdom of God shall see my face no more. Wherefore, I take you to record this day that I am pure from the blood of all men. For I have not shunned to declare unto you all the counsel of God. Take heed, therefore, unto yourselves, and to all the flock over the which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers, to feed the church of God, which he hath purchased with his own blood. May the Lord bless again the reading of his word, and bless you for our hearts. channel by the only mediator, the Lord Jesus Christ, who paid the price, to pay that unpayable price, to redeem us from the vanity of this evil world. Oh Lord, maybe we think this world is all what there is, but deep down in our state and condition, deep down in our souls, in our spirits, and even in our conscience, it is implanted that there is life after death. And we pray, Lord, that we will come to a full realization that indeed it is appointed unto men once to die, then comes the judgment. But we thank thee, Lord, that there is a way to avoid that judgment, not to be condemned. Oh Lord, there is a way to be acquitted, not by good works, not because we have done better or because we can earn it or deserve it, but because the Savior, the perfect one, the blameless one, the righteous one, paid the price. And now he is sitting at the right hand of God in the heavenly places and preparing a place. And he promised that when that place is being prepared, he will come back. Oh Lord, we pray that thou will visit us in this place tonight, that thou will do good to our souls. Our souls are dormant. They are in great lack. They are in great want. They are thirsty. They are hungry after righteousness. But Lord, we know we live in a world that is like a mirage. It shows to us water, but indeed we die without the Lord Jesus Christ with great insatisfaction. And we pray, Lord, that in this place, as the gospel is being preached from thy word, we pray that the gracious Holy Spirit will take our feeble words, our unworthy and insufficient words, to apply them to a seeker, to apply them to the one who has seen the vanity of this world and who is looking up to the Savior. Oh Lord, we pray that thou will not forsake us. Do not leave us to ourselves. We have that animal part in us which will lead us to perdition. But we pray, Lord, that thou will smile upon us, that thou will look upon each one of us. Why should we die of hunger while there is plenty of food in Christ? Why should we live homeless while there is a shelter, there is a refuge, an eternal refuge? Once it's done, it will never be undone. The roof will never be removed over our heads, because this is an eternal refuge given to us by the God who cannot lie, the God who is immortal, the God who lives forever, the God who is with us, Emmanuel. Oh Lord, please do what no preaching can do. We pray that thou will visit us, and in the secret of our hearts again, we have seen it even in this place, we can call it a place of blessing, a place of salvation. So we pray that thou will help us, Lord, and make thy word to have its place, the only place it should have in our lives, if we are not arrogant, presumptuous, and proud people. But we pray, Lord, that thou will help us to swallow our pride, and instead of taking things of this into ourselves, but to take the great promises that thou hast given to us. Oh Lord, we pray that thou will give the same blessings to other places where the gospel will be preached tonight and throughout this day, this Lord's day. Oh Lord, we thank thee that thou hast heard our prayers so many times. We have proved thee, and we know thou art trustworthy. We pray for each one of us. Oh Lord, move mightily in our midst. We pray that thy word will speak to us admonish us, instruct us, furnish our minds with the things of great value, not the petty things of this world. But Lord, we pray that we will be deep people, not just living for the here and now. Lord, thy word is eternal. The grass may dry and wither away and taken by the wind, but thy word is eternal. And we pray that seed will be sown in our hearts to bring us to regeneration. Oh Lord, we pray that there will be that work of the Spirit in each one of us. Bless us, Lord, again, and bless our praises, bless our prayers, bless the preaching of thy word. Make this place a place of salvation, Lord, as we ask all these mercies in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Sing our third hymn, hymn number 304. Hymn number 304. Day of judgment. Day of oneness.
Testifying, Paul is speaking to the elders
of the Church of Ephesus, and in verse 21, testifying both to the Jews and also to the Greeks, repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. So, my title tonight is the Duet of Salvation. I could have spoken about the solo of salvation. I could have spoken about the triad of the triplet of salvation. But just to keep it simple, two elements, two ingredients in relation to salvation. What is the purpose of life? Why do we live? Where are we going? These are essential and existential questions. Everyone is asking, unless we live in another planet, why are we here? Where are we going? What's the purpose of all this? Why there is this world? So these are important questions. And the Bible says, if we only live for the here and now, if our hope is only in this world, we are the most miserable of all men. But I think, I try to convince myself that nobody is here in this place just living for the here and now, just for self. So in the book of Acts is really replete with many conversions, endless conversions. And actually, the first sermon which was preached in the book of Acts, we are told there were 3,000 men, 3,000 conversions, then later 5,000 and so on. So it is replete with many conversions. But for any conversion to take place, there must be, I insist on it, there must be repentance toward God and faith toward the Lord Jesus Christ. These two elements, these two ingredients are essential to salvation, and they are inseparable from salvation. You cannot separate them, you cannot dissociate them from salvation. They are essential. If it's only repentance, if you have repented and did not put your faith on the Lord Jesus Christ, please allow me to call that self-pity, remorse. Just remorse. If you have put your faith on the Lord Jesus Christ and you have never repented, please allow me to call that morality. Just morality. Rules and regulations. But when repentance towards God and faith toward the Lord Jesus Christ are taking place at the same time, there is salvation. So that's basic teaching of the Bible. But now, as you look at the way Paul is explaining these things before he comes to those things and explain them to his hearers, my dear friends, he speaks to them, look at verse 24, just very quickly. Verse 24, he said again there, I have testified, the last part, the end of the verse, I have testified to you the gospel of the grace of God. And I'm sure you know the word gospel means good news. The word grace means undeserved favor from God through his good pleasure. Then verse 25, he adds something again, preaching the kingdom of God. You see, there is the kingdom of the world and there is the kingdom of God. There is the good news of salvation and there is the doom and the condemnation upon this world. But that's not all. In verse 26, he adds something else. And he said to them, I'm pure from the blood of all men. Then I go back to verse 20. And Paul says there, and how I kept back nothing. I shrink what is profitable to your soul, all that is necessary to your soul, was given by revelation. That's why we have the Bible. It is given. So please don't look for it anywhere else. It is given. We have it. It is here, revealed. There is nothing more to come. Please don't wait for better days. This is the time. All is here. What do I need to be saved? How do a person become a Christian? Paul is going to give us what made his ministry. If you want, everything is condensed for us in just two key phrases. Just two key phrases. And this will really be the two points, the two headings of our thinking tonight. What must I do to be saved? How can I be saved? How can I have my sins forgiven? How can I have fellowship with God? How can I heal myself, my fault? Not just as a God, a divinity, or a deity, somewhere there, aloof from me, distant and disinterested from me, but he comes so low, so near, so into a great proximity, that now I can see him with the eyes of faith, I can touch him with the hands of faith, I can hear him with the spiritual ears. How could that happen? Very simple. Paul is giving us these two things. If you want to have fellowship with God tonight, he wants your sins to be forgiven. These are essential. And the first one, Paul says in verse 21, repentance toward God. And the second one is faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. So we go one by one, and I hope I will make it as simple as I can. But this is essential. This is essential. All what is profitable, Paul kept nothing. The Lord Jesus Christ kept nothing. All is given. So the first thing Paul says in verse 21, testifying both to the Jews and also to the Greeks, repentance toward God. This is the starting point. You must start here. Repentance. Please remember, we said repentance without faith is self-pity, and faith without repentance is just morality. And all religions are moral. All of them. But the only religion that has a savior is the religion of the Bible, Christianity, according to the Bible. So the starting point is repentance. That's the fundamental milestone. Christ said, you don't need to turn there, but in Luke chapter 13, it is so important that he kept repeating it. He kept emphasizing on it. And he said, except ye repent, ye shall all perish likewise. So you can see the message, this is not to scare anyone, that's not the purpose. But really, it's important, unless we repent. Children can repent, adults can repent, men can repent, women can repent, all sorts of people. It is available. Repentance is available to all of us. But please, there is a sharp precision. The word of God wastes no words. Every word there is important. Do you see something with the word repentance? You see, repentance must have an object, a special object. I'm sorry to use the word object, but I'm sure you understand what I mean. Repentance must have a person. And it says in the text, repentance toward God. Repentance toward God. Repentance with respect to God. Repentance in relation to God. Repentance in view to God. Otherwise, people are repenting every day. You know that. They're repenting every day. They have remorse, they have regret, they have contrition, they have even broken heart. But it's just as I said, self-pity. Oh dear, this is happening to me. I fell in such a huge and gross sin. My world is upside down. What else? But this is important. Repentance toward God. Very important. I can give you, I will illustrate what I'm saying so that it becomes clearer and clearer as we move on. The best example I can give you is the prodigal son. If you have ever read the Bible, I'm speaking to those who are not familiar with the Word of God, but at least this is a key chapter. And there is a young man there, we call him the prodigal son. No time to explain to you why he's called prodigal, but this is a young man who said, "Father, I wish you were dead. Give me, give me." But we say the same. If you are a non-believer, you are here, most people, they think God is a killjoy. When you speak about God, "God, you know, I cannot party, I cannot do what I want, I cannot feast." You see, they see God just as somebody who makes things not to work as they should. But this young man, he went far from his father. I wouldn't dare give you the whole account. But there, in the far country, he came to his senses. And you know what he said? "I have sinned against God." You see, "I have sinned against God. And I have sinned against my father." So every sin you have committed in your life, and you are a sinner. You are a sinner by nature. I'm a sinner by nature and by choice. Every sin you have committed, first and foremost, is against God. And David, in Psalm 51, will repeat the same thing, will say exactly the same thing, but saying, "I have sinned against thee and against thee alone, and I have done this evil thing." And you know, David's adultery, he murdered, he lied, he has hidden his sin and so on, trying to cover it. So all these things he has committed them against Bathsheba, against Uriah, but when he's making his confession, he said, "Against thee, and thee alone, I have sinned, and I have done this evil thing." So my dear friends, repentance means I have to implore the Lord. I have to implore God. I have to cry unto God. I have sinned against God. I deserve to die. I do not, shouldn't have any fellowship with God, my Creator. So that's the first thing. And our sins are first and foremost against God. Our dissolution, our dissipation, our promiscuity, our evil ways, our wicked ways, our bad thoughts, evil thoughts, our nature, in thoughts, in words, in deeds, everything is against heaven. Heaven is offended. And that's why there is no way. But to open to you the gates of heaven, the first thing Bible says, I must repent. And I will explain. So repentance implores God. Repentance prays to God. "I have sinned against thee. In my nature, all the evil things I have thought and said against thee, I confess, and Lord, forgive me." That's really the heart of repentance in a sinner's life. You see, we did not capture our nature as sinners like you catch a boat. No, it is in our nature. It is what we are, and we practice it daily. So that's why we are separated from the living God. We are separated because of sin. And repentance, the simplest definition given by preachers all the time. Repentance means I turn away from my sin. And I turn. See, it's never possible. I turn away from the evil ways. And I turn to God. So, repentance is made of a strong desire. Repentance is made of a strong determination. I will explain. Lord, I want to do good. I abhor my sin. I do not love it anymore. King sin, king me, king self is dethroned. And I see the darkness in my heart. I see the darkness in my mind. And and I see God is light. God is bright. I cannot approach him in a shallow way. I cannot fellowship with him in a flippant and volatile mind. I have to be serious about the things I'm saying to God. And my perception about God, about self, about sin, about the Lord Jesus Christ must end. Lord, I do not want just to turn a leaf. You know, people, when they have remorse, they take a resolution, I'm going to turn a new leaf. But please, don't turn a new leaf. You need a new life. You need a new life. That's why salvation is not revolution, but it is about redemption. Yes, there will be a spiritual revolution, but I need redemption. It's not just resolutions. God, help me in this, God, help me in my exam, help me to become richer, help me. You see, then you are making of God just a servant. I need you, give me this. If you don't give me this, then I don't have you. But God is Lord, he's the master. We should be the servant. We should be the one listening to him. So what is repentance? True repentance is a godly sorrow. And the conscience, you see the mind again? It is a godly sorrow and the conscience turning to God. I turn consciously with all my faculties, heart, mind, and will, I turn to the living God. That's why I said, repentance is not the same as remorse. And I give you an example of somebody who had great remorse. Judas in the Bible. He even said, when you read his record, his testimony, he even said, I have sinned. But you see, remorse takes into account just the judgment, the punishment on that present moment. I want to save my neck. I have done this. Then, oh Lord, I have sinned. But repentance takes into account all my sins at all times. That's the big difference. Remorse looks into self. While repentance says, no, there is nothing good in me. I look to God, he's holy, he's thrice holy, and I'm wicked, I'm a wretched sinner. There is no good in me at all. That's really what repentance is all about. You know, Judas again, what did he do? Instead of turning to God, he turned away from God, and he hanged himself. But the difference, Peter, this we know about Peter, his repentance, 3 times he denied the Lord, and then in his repentance, he said, what the text says that he wept bitterly, and in his tears were not crocodile tears, they were sincere. They were sincere, because he knew that he has sinned against the Lord Jesus Christ, and now he wants to turn to the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's why in his encounter with the Lord Jesus in John chapter 21, the Lord said to him, feed my sheep, because he was reestablished, he was restored, because his tears, when he wept, it was sincere, it was from his heart and from his mind. And he was willing to look unto himself as God sees him. So, repentance is to look at all my sins and to look at the cross of Calvary, where Christ died to pay for my sins. Repentance makes me to see the weeds that are cluttering the garden of my soul. It is dirty there. The tares have grown wild. And unless the physician of soul visits my soul, I will die away from the living God. So repentance says, I make no excuse. I don't blame anyone. I don't blame the church. I don't blame my parents. People do that day after day. I blame myself. I do not conceal my sin. And we read Psalm 38. The psalmist there said, I have declared my iniquity. That's the confession of a repentant sinner. I have declared openly, I have not hidden my transgressions, my trespasses to God. I have declared them openly to him. And the Lord to be merciful unto me. O Oh, can I give you, I feel I have not explained it good. Can I give you another example? In 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 9, we are told that the people, the Thessalonians, they were so repentant. Their repentance was so real. They turned to God from their idols to serve the true and living God. You see again repentance there? They turn away from their idols and they turn to God, the true and living God, the only God. That's repentance. Can I give you another example? We are not far. Look at Acts chapter 19. Acts chapter 19. Just one verse. You will see the magicians there. These people were sorcerers. They were witchcraft and playing with people's minds and hearts. But when they heard the gospel, to show their repentance, it's in Acts chapter 19 and verse 17, 18, and 19. It's all there. And to show that they have really repented and they have forsaken their old life, they brought all their books, the books they were using in order to snare and trick people with their manipulation. They brought them and the books were burned. And we are told that the price of those books were 50,000 pieces of silver. Do you know how much that cost? 50,000 days of wages in our modern time equivalent. 50,000 days wages. They didn't say, let's sell these books and give the money to the church. Cursed is the money. Cursed is that money. They burn it because it was a part of their whole life. I can give you the example of a man called Zacchaeus in the Word of God. When he repented in Luke chapter 19, he did the same. He said, I'm going to repay back four times the people I have cheated, the people for whom I have taken, distortion and took their property, took their money, I'm willing to pay back. That is true repentance. Have you come to that, to an end of self and looking unto God? But I must come to the second heading. Repentance toward God. And the second one is faith on our Lord Jesus Christ. Faith toward, again, with respect of our Lord Jesus Christ. My dear friends, repentance must be quickly, not today, followed by faith. And Hebrews 11 verse 6 says, without faith, it is impossible to please God. It is impossible. Faith is essential. You must believe that God exists. He made you, He created you, He provides for you, He gives you good health, He gives you a roof over your head, He gives you education, He gives you everything you have. Belongs to Him. Actually, we are stealing from Him. And that's why one day He must judge us. But you see, saving faith must direct you and me to the person of the Lord Jesus Christ again. You see, repentance towards God and repentance towards our Lord Jesus Christ. Christ said in John 14, you know the passage, He said, ye believe in God, believe also in me. Please, do you see that? Do you see that Christ is divine? Do you see the divinity of Christ in that passage? Oh, I took you John 14. But do you see the divinity of Christ in this passage? Please read it again. Repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. Do you see God? Do you see Christ? God is Christ. Christ is God. The invisible God made Himself to be visible in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. If you don't believe me, please read later Colossians chapter 1, verse 15. Christ is the image of the invisible God. We have been created in the image of God, but we are not the image of God, but Christ is. If you want, Christ is the stamp of God. You look at Christ, whom do you see? A great prophet? No. A great philosopher? No. That's too small. A great example? No, no, no. Do you see he's called Lord Jesus Christ? Not just a small prophet. So your faith is not just in a mere man. This is the Lord, the one who made heaven and earth. You read John chapter 1, Christ is the creator. You read Colossians chapter 1 again, Christ is the creator. You know, all things have been created by him, and it's interesting there, it says also, all things have been created for him. You have been created for him. But in our rebellion, in our pride, you say, no, 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 I have been created for myself. I want to enjoy myself. So faith on the Lord Jesus Christ. That's really what makes us to be saved. Repentance toward God and faith toward the Lord Jesus Christ. Without his atoning death on the cross of Calvary, no salvation. No salvation. He was born of a virgin. He lived a perfect life. He was hanged on a cross. He was put in a grave. On the third day, he was risen from the dead. Why? Because he's immortal. He's immortal. He's the life, he's life giver. But someone may ask me, what is faith? Faith is to trust. Faith is to believe. Faith is to commit yourself to the Lord Jesus Christ, which means I come to grasp why Christ suffered. I should be on that cross. Even today, if it was not by grace, I should be on that cross being judged. But I have come to understand I was saved at age 22, rebellious. I have insulted and offended my Savior. I lived just for myself, or I lived, I'm sorry to say, I lived for a religion. But that religion couldn't save me. You asked me, will you be going to heaven? I don't know. But Christ gives us certainty. In my last sermon here, when I spoke to you, I said, you know why we can know, we can have assurance of salvation, we can know if you are saved or not? Because salvation is free. It is free on God's part, because he paid for it. A great price was paid to save us. So please, don't think it was a cheap grace. A great price was paid for you and me to give us fellowship with the living God. I have grasped that, and I understood that Christ is not just a prophet of a religion, but he's the Savior. He died on the cross of Calvary to pay for our sins. He paid the price for my guilt. He took the bankruptcy of my life. He took my hell. Can I sum it up to you in one verse? One verse, if you understand this verse, it tells you all you need to know to be saved and all what Christ has done for you to give you a place in heaven, to unlock the kingdom of God, to unlock the gates of heaven for you. It is 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9, a well-known verse. And in that passage, it says, for ye know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that yet through his poverty might be rich. There is no religion, there is no prophet in the world who will enrich you through his poverty. They all seek for riches. But the Lord Jesus Christ, though he was rich, the whole world, heaven belonged to him. But he humbled himself. What a condescendence to become so small, a man, God becoming a man. Normally, if we're really godly people, you and me, as soon as the name of the Lord Jesus Christ is pronounced, you know, if we were really godly people, what should we be doing? We should be falling on our knees to worship him. But our depravity is so high, so big, that it doesn't affect us anymore. That's why in the world the name Jesus became a swearing name. As you can see, he was rich, but he made himself poor. But even through his poverty, to make you and me rich in terms of salvation. think about another verse in the Bible which says, even the foolishness of God is wiser than our greatest wisdom. You can see the paradox. That's the beauty of believing on the Lord Jesus Christ. My time is over, but this is faith is confessing Him with your mouth and believing in your heart. So believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Believe on His atoning death. Comply to the gospel. Christ shed His blood for the remission of our sins. Forgiveness, cleansing, relationship is through Him. And we have all the forgiveness of our sins. He was delivered on the cross of Calvary for our sins, so that we may be delivered also from all sins. So Christ is really the Savior. Salvation is a mighty deed of God in a sinner's life. I close with this. The war is over. There is reconciliation if you repent and trust on the Lord Jesus Christ. But here, look at verse 21. There is something you shouldn't miss and I shouldn't miss. He says that, testifying both to the Jews and also to the Greeks. What does it mean? Salvation is available to all. The religionists, the Jews, the rationalists, the Greeks, the Gentiles, you and me, actually. So salvation is available to all men. Not that all men will be saved. What stops you from coming to the Lord tonight? Is it pride? Is it arrogance? Is it foolishness? Is it just because, really, these things don't matter at all to you? You are vague, a vague person. No, there is something to do while you are still alive. You repent and you put your trust on the Lord Jesus Christ. This is real egalitarianism. That's where we are all equal. You know, the governments in their constitution can write we are all equal, but decrees will not make people to be equal. Here is where we are all equal. You come to the Lord Jesus Christ in fear, trembling, trusting on Him. At the cross of Calvary, we are all equal. But once saved, we are also all equal. The priesthood of all believers. So change your attitude towards sin, self, Christ, and God. Repentance toward God and faith towards the Lord Jesus Christ. Transform a sinner into a new man, a saint. Salvation for whosoever believeth. So please make sure tonight, if you have never sought and found the Lord, make sure to ask the Lord to give you repentance and faith. And as we put it often, if you cannot come to Him by faith, come to Him for faith. Come to Him for faith, and He will give it to you. Free of charge. You will be renewed. You will have a new character, new nature, new fellowship. You will be a new person, a saint. A sinner is transformed into being a saint. Repentance toward God and faith toward the Lord Jesus Christ. This is the doing of salvation. Let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father, we come to Thee not with our own merits, but with the merits of the Lord Jesus Christ. All of these things should move our hearts. These things should move our lives. But we know, unless there is the hammer of Thy word to break our rocky hearts, the mountain of our sins will never be cast away. But Lord, we pray that the gracious Holy Spirit will move us and pierce our hearts so we may see the vanity of life without the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, bless each one of us. We need Thee, Lord. Do not pass by us without touching us, Lord. We pray that salvation will knock again to the heart of a sinner and give him the new birth, redemption through through the precious blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Depth of mercy. Can there be mercy still reserved for me? Now and forevermore.